531, if you would. 531, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Let's all stand together as we sing. 531 together. On that first.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's rich, ye ransomed from
singing. Good to see you in church today and Memorial Day weekend, and I'm glad you're home, and I'm glad you came to church this morning because you're home, and good to see you in the service this morning. Let's bow for prayer together, shall we? Father, we bow before you today, and Lord, we want to thank you for the freedom we enjoy in this country, and Lord, thank you for the men and the women that have gone before us, and especially those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice and laid down their life for their country. And Lord, we're grateful for that. And we're grateful for those believers who have gone before us and have laid down their lives for the cause of Christ, that we might have the Word of God today and the freedom to gather together and assemble here this morning. And Lord, you've blessed our country. And Lord, I'm praying today for America. I'm praying you'll bring our country back to you. Lord, we need you again in our country. We acknowledge that. And I pray, Lord, that you'll do a work in our hearts today and in the hearts of many people across this country as we gather together in our churches. Speak to our hearts. Begin to help us to turn to you and turn away from our wicked ways. And Lord, I pray you'll hear from heaven, you'll forgive our sin, and you'll heal our land. Now, Father, have your way in our service here today. Thank you, Lord, for the wonderful promise that we just sang about, when one day we're going to gather together in heaven and sing all hail the power of Jesus' name. What a day that'll be. And Lord, I pray until that time you'll find us faithful and that you'll minister to our hearts this morning as only you can do. So Lord, help us to yield ourselves to you and to allow you to work in each one of our lives this morning. Have your way in the service in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And it's still the blood that saves from sin. Still the blood that cleanses within. From the highest shore in heaven depths of the sea, it's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. Once I wondered in sin's black night, there was a way I could make my wrongs right, and the old accuser to the Lord did cry. Father, I'll go. from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It is still the blood of Jesus. Oh, it's still the blood of Jesus. Yes, it's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me.
Amen. Amen. That's great. 129, 129, mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. Battle Hymn of the Republic. We're going to sing that first, third, and last together. On that first.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible sweet sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never sound retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our God is marching. The beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us fly to make them free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory.
All right, listen carefully now. A few announcements for you this morning. We have our regular schedule tonight. 5:30 is our Christian growth class, and we meet in the conference room at 5:30. And tonight's lesson will be on baptism. Baptism, the next step you take after salvation is to be baptized and understand what that's all about and what the significance of that is. That'll be 5:30 in the conference room tonight. Then 6:30, we'll be back here in the auditorium for our evening service. And Lord willing, tonight, 6:30, we'll be talking about some things to remember. Some things to remember. And we'll observe the Lord's table tonight in our service. And so we hope you'll be back tonight for the evening service. And right after the service tonight, we'll have just a quick meeting of all of those going on the missions trip to Mexico. We've got everything finalized now with our transportation, and we want to let you know about that and just make sure everybody has everything they need and know what they need to bring and all those good things. All right, so just a quick meeting to get everybody on the same page. That'll be right after the service tonight. All right. And then remember, next Sunday evening, June 5th, the teens will be having their last fundraiser for the missions trip to help defer some of the cost of the teenagers going on the trip. And they'll have some Sunday night snacks, all right, right after the service Sunday evening. So plan to stay around and fellowship with us on Sunday night, and you'll be helping the teens towards their missions trip, all right? I think that's all I've got right now. Let's take a minute, and let's welcome any visitors we have with us in our service this morning. If you're visiting today, not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, would you put your hand up in the air? We'd love to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. Right here in the middle. Brenda, I'm going to introduce you and your brother, would you please? Mm-hmm. Amen. That's great, Brenda. Glad you and Jeremy came back today, and Jan gave them a ride. They live in the you live in the university area, don't you? Ohio State area there. And but Jan, because of nursing home this afternoon, cannot take them back home. Is there anybody that might be able to give them a ride home after church to where they live? Leland, you can do that? Okay, you see Leland back there? Okay. And you make sure you connect with them after church, and if you'll drop them off, that'd be a blessing, okay? Thank you for doing that. Appreciate it. Wonderful. All right, anybody else here today for the first time? All right, right down front here, okay? What's your name, hon? Edith? Okay, good to have you. And whose guest are you? Did you come with somebody? You came with Emma. Are you her friend? That's wonderful. We were hoping Emma would get a friend. And thank you for being here today, Edith. That's great. Boy, they bring you right to the front row. How about that, huh? And that's great. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we appreciate you doing that. And in a little bit, when we have the offering, just put that card in the plate, if you would. And keep the pen as our gift to you for coming this morning. We're glad you're here. Let's give these visitors a warm welcome, shall we?
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. 463. Let's sing that first together. Oh, and the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more. And the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let's sing that last together. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Amen. Great singing this morning. 127. Let's turn over to 127. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of green. Let's all stand together again, if you would. 127. As we sing this first stanza, children, if you'll go out to junior church, you are dismissed to junior church. On that first together.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of green. Stern and passion stress, the thoroughfare for freedom beat across the wilderness. America, America, mend thy free floor, confirm thy soul in self-control, thy
amen. Great one another. Make someone feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing those last stanzas together. Thank you. Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every gain divine. Let's sing that last together. Oh, beautiful for patriot dream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Keep your book open there for just a minute. And, of course, the last verse is great. But, you know, it's when the song was written, it says, thine alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears. When that song was written, there'd never been an attack on America. That verse is not quite true anymore. Our cities have been hit, and we have shed tears in America because of attack on America. But you were still milling about a lot. Verse 3 is a tremendous verse. And I want to sing that verse over again. Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every gain divine. If it's not divine, it's not a gain, it's a loss. And so let's sing that third verse and remember those who, in liberating strife, more than self, their country loved, and mercy more than life. Okay, let's sing that third stanza together. Bob will lead us.
Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved,
said? Amen. Amen. Be seated if you will. Ushers are coming. We'll have our offering here. Give as the Lord has blessed and prospered you through the week. And if any of you want to help someone go to Mexico, just put whatever you'd like to donate and just put Mexico on it, and we'll apply that to some who may need some help with the Mexico. It may be a great blessing to someone who's been praying and asking God to provide, and maybe you're not able to with your schedule to go, but you could put something towards someone going. That could be a life-changing event for them, and you might be the answer to their prayer for God to provide. So if you can do that, you just put that in today or tonight, and that'd be great. All right, let's pray for our offering this morning. Brother Pole, I'd like you to lead us, if you would.
Pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us, where we come in and hear the word of God preached and then apply it to our life. We pray that you'd be with each one that's here today as they give and they give them unto you. We ask that it be spent wisely, and we do pray that if you're able to help someone go to the Mexico trip, that you'd give in today. And we pray that you'd bless the service and bless the pastor. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Take your Bible this morning, if you would, please, for our scripture reading, and go to Exodus chapter 17, please. Exodus chapter 17. We are going to read verses 8 through 16 of Exodus chapter 17. And we read the verses responsively, begin together on verse 8, then I'll read 9. We'll alternate reading like that till we end together on verse 16 of Exodus chapter 17. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture this morning. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 8 of Exodus 17. Ready? Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill with the rod of God in mine hand. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. And the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book, and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. For I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. For he said, because the Lord hath sworn that the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the Bible, and thank you for allowing us to have copies of your word in our hand this morning. Lord, we don't believe it just to be the words of men or the words of a man. We believe this to be the very words of God. And I pray it will effectually work in each of us who believe here this morning. You'll help us to glean from this passage what you would have for us today. So may our hearts be ready, and may you open them and open our understanding of the scriptures today. Bless the special. In Christ's name, amen.
Once my soul was astray from the heavenly way, and was wretched and vile as could be. But my Savior in love gave me peace from above when he reached down his hand for me. When my Savior reached down for me, when he reached way down for me, I was lost and undone without God or his Son when he reached down his hand for me. I was near to despair when he came to me there, and he showed me that I could be free. Then he lifted my feet, he gave me gladness complete, when he reached down his hand for me. When my Savior reached down for me, when he reached way down for me, I was lost and undone without God or his Son. When he reached down his hand for me, how my heart does rejoice when I hear his sweet voice. In the tempest to him I then flee, there to lean on his arm, safe, secure from all harm, since he reached down his hand for me. When my Savior reached down for me, when he reached way down for me, I was lost and undone without God or his Son. When he reached down his hand for me.
That's good. I like that song. Doesn't sound quite as good as it does in my car running down the freeway when I'm singing at the top of my lungs, but that was pretty good, Bob. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the wonderful music today. Thank you for the wonderful truths that we've heard already in song. And Father, we bow before you now as we open up your word and we look into your inspired word this morning, that you would minister to the hearts of people today as only you can do. Lord, I pray you'll help me as I bring the message to say what I ought to say and leave unsaid what does not need to be said. I'd like to preach in the Spirit. I'd like the people to listen in the Spirit today. That they would hear a Spirit-led preacher and be Spirit-led followers. And Lord, I pray that your will would be done in each of our lives today as we look into your word. And help us to not forget these things that we'll look at this morning. So, Father, minister to each of your people as only you can. Holy Spirit, be our guide. And I'll thank you now for what I believe you'll do. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. There are times when we can be very forgetful. Anybody struggle with that? One day after Albert Einstein had moved to his home at the Institute of Advanced Study in Princeton, New Jersey, the telephone rang in the office of the dean of the Princeton Graduate School, and the voice at the other end of the phone inquired, "May I speak with Dr. Einstein, please?" Well, the receptionist advised that he was not in, and then the voice continued, "Well, perhaps then you could tell me where Dr. Einstein lives." And, of course, the secretary replied she could not do that, since she would believe Dr. Einstein would want his privacy protected. And, of course, then there was a whisper on the other end of the phone that said, "Please don't tell anyone, but I am Dr. Einstein, and I'm on my way home. And I've forgotten where my house is." True story. You know, we can forget things so easily. And each of you probably would have your own story about something that you forgot about or didn't remember. You know, you can, maybe it's when you get together and maybe you'll get together with family on Memorial Day and sometimes your children or someone will begin to recount some story from the past. And yeah, sometimes it's easy to say, "Oh, I forgot about that. I don't remember that. I had forgotten that that had even happened. Well, I want you to hold your finger in Exodus 17. We're going to come back to that passage, but I'd like you to look over in the book of Psalms with me, would you please? And go to the 78th Psalm. Psalm 78. This forgetfulness is something that happened to Israel. Notice, verse number 3 of Psalm 78 says, that which we have heard and known and our fathers have told us, we will not hide them from their children, showing to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and His strength and His wonderful works that He hath done. For He established a testimony in Jacob, and He appointed a law in Israel, which He commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that the generation to come might know them, even the children which should be born, who should arise and declare them to their children, that they might set their hope in God and not, what church? Not forget the works of God, but keep His commandments, and might not be as their fathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, a generation that set not their heart aright, and whose spirit was not steadfast with God. The children of Ephraim, being armed and carrying bows, turned back in the day of battle, and kept not the covenant of God, and refused to walk in His law, and forgot His works and His wonders that He had showed them. Sad thing for Israel, a terrible thing had happened in Israel. They'd forgotten what God had done for them. They had forgotten the mighty works of God. They had just let them slip from their memory. Now, let's go back to Exodus 17 and understand what has taken place here. The Amalekites have set the battle in array, and God has told Israel to go ahead and fight the Amalekites, and Joshua is the captain of the host, and he's going to lead them in battle against the Amalekites. And what has taken place here is Moses says, I'm going to go watch the battle from up here on the hill. And Aaron and Hur go up with Moses, and he takes the rod of God in his hand. And anytime Moses raises the rod of God and has it up, Israel's winning the battle. But as he gets tired and he lets that drop, then they noticed the Amalekites would begin to advance. And so Aaron and Hur decided, I know what we need to do. We need to hold up the arms of Moses. And so they both got one on one side, one on the other side, and they held those arms up, and Israel won the battle, and they defeated the Amalekites. And God tells him to do something here. Notice what he said. Verse number 14. The Lord said unto Moses, write. Up until this time, by the way, that's the first occurrence of the word write in the Bible. First time God told them to write something down is Deuteronomy 17:14. Up until that time, how did they know what was coming or know what had happened? It was all verbal. This time he said, Moses, I'm not just wanting something you talk about. I want you to write this down. And when you write it down, it's going to be a memorial in a book. You're going to write it down in a book, and then you're going to rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. And you're going to write down what happened today, and you're going to continually rehearse it. When you rehearse something, what do you do? Over and over and over again. All right? You're practicing it. You're rehearsing it. You're going the same thing over and over and over again. And you keep rehearsing it. Why? Because God says, I do not want them to forget this. And so I want you to rehearse it in their ears. And so I'm going to, and you know, there's some things, listen, I'm not going to keep you long this morning, but there are some things that we ought not to forget. There's some things that if need be, we ought to write down. If need be, you ought to rehearse them. And one way to not to forget them is to rehearse them. One of those things, the first thing I think you ought never forget, is people who've been friends through your years or through the years. It's here for Israel, and particularly Joshua, Every time he would hear this story, he not only remembered the victory over the Amalekites and the victory that they won that day, but I'm sure he'd think of Moses, and for sure he'd think of Aaron and Hur, who held up the arms of Moses so they could win the victory. And you know, when if you've been saved, and this coming September will be 34 years in ministry for me. And you know, I thank God through the years of the people who God has given me who always held up the hands, held up the arms of the pastor. My wife and I were talking the other day about someone who's close to us, and they had a bad experience in the ministry, and just some folks who weren't very kind and nice, and over 20 years ago, I think they got out of the ministry and just worked secular work and stayed involved in church and serving God, but not pastoring, and just this last week accepted a pastorate again. And they're going to get back in the ministry. And it's just that they were hurt deeply by people. And, you know, I thank God. In the 34 years of ministry, I've never had to experience that. Never had to go through that where someone just opposes you. And just you know, goes head-to-head at you. People, sometimes preachers make jokes about deacons, you know. We had a demons meeting last night, you know what I mean? And they call the deacons the demons. And I've never had that experience. I've always had good men and faithful men and men who love God and men who wanted to further the work of God and men who followed the pastor. And I've always had good, faithful people. And God's given that here as well. And there's, you know, Bob and Kay Wallace now 10 years. Over 10 years, and they were one of the ones that helped vote us in, and the stayed by the stuff, and holding up the arms of the pastor, doing whatever they can do to help the pastor, and others here in the church, and the Andersons all 10 years, Dave and Jeanette, and the Taylors, I think 9 years for you guys, and that's amazing, isn't it? And it was August of 2007 that you got married, wasn't it? Wow, that's amazing. That seemed like that was just the other day. And I'm sure it seems that way to you too. Amen. That's a good spot for amen right there, Don. All right. And and of course, Carol Treadway's here. She's been here the whole time. Carol Hoskins been here the whole time. Bob and Tanya, 9 years. And others, 8 years and 7 years. And just folks who, and listen, there are times, say, you mean everybody always sees eye to eye with the pastor? No. I don't even see eye to eye with the pastor all the time, and I'm the pastor, so I'm not asking that, or I don't expect that. And by the way, when someone got, we had a fellow one time who took issue with invitations, and said he didn't think you ought to have invitations in church. Well, I'm nice about it and kind about it, but I just kindly told him, if that's what you're looking for, then you're probably in the wrong church. And you know, by the grace of God, he agreed, and they went somewhere else. And that's okay. That's all right. I want him to be happy where he is and doing, you know, where he can think he's in the greatest church in the world. And we'll keep doing what we believe God wants us to do. But I'm so thankful. You know, there's times in the ministry that the pastor's arms get tired. And it's great to have people who lift up his hands. And sometimes they're not, listen, I'm grateful for the ones through the years. Years ago, I started pastoring when I was 24 years of age. And so I was pastoring people who sometimes were twice my age. And I wasn't yet, let me think here. I wasn't 30 years of age yet. And we had a work day. I might have been just 30, but we had a work day. And I had a retired minister in my church from North Dakota named Marvin Bostow. And Marvin would always tell me, he said, "Preacher," if he had a raspy voice, he said, "if God be in your plans, make them big. If God be in your plans, make them big." I never forgot that. And it was a work day at church, and Marvin was retired, and he was so crippled with arthritis, you know, couldn't straighten his fingers out or anything. And he showed up one time on a work day, and he walks up carrying a hammer in his hand. Now, he ain't about to hammer anything. He can't even hold the hammer in his hand. I said, "Marvin, what are you doing here, man?" He goes, "Just wanted to let everybody know whose side I'm on." He's on the pastor's side. He's on the preacher's side. And he's ready to work. See, those are the kind of folks that you don't forget. And I thank God that He's blessed me with people like that through the years. And just staying by the stuff. People who are faithful. And I appreciate so much the people. Listen, Tuesday, we said last Sunday night because of the rain that we had. And by the way, I'm thankful we had the fair on that Saturday and not yesterday. First of all, yesterday, it really rained when it rained. I couldn't believe it. And it was hot before it rained. And especially if you'd have been standing on blacktop, you'd have been hot. And so God was good to us. And it was a beautiful day, but things were wet. And, man, I just asked for some guys to come on Tuesday and get things dried out and put away. And I was out of town on Tuesday, and we got back Wednesday afternoon. And before church Wednesday night, I just opened the door to that fellowship hall, and I just couldn't believe it. Everything is cleaned out and looks sharp, and I haven't opened the shed yet, but everything, I'm sure that looks great too. But I just rejoice in my heart of faithful servants of God, and just showed up. And if you were one of those folks, just thank you so much for putting the things away and just serving when nobody knows. Nobody's going to applaud you. Nobody sees it. I tell you who saw it. God saw it. God saw it. And He knows what you did. So just think about it this morning. If you've been saved any length of time, you've been serving God any length of time, would you just think this morning, who's encouraged you along the way? Who's been a blessing to you along the way? And maybe as you have Memorial Day and you begin not to, you know, don't forget people like that. Maybe you ought to express your gratitude to them. Who's held your arms up when you've been in a struggle? When you got a little weary, you're tended to just let down and say, I don't think I can do it anymore. And somebody came along and said, let me hold you up. I mean, somebody came in when everybody else was going out. And they were always there for you. Maybe you ought to thank them today and not forget about them. Don't walk around saying, well, nobody appreciates me. Oh, get off that. And then start thinking about, who do I appreciate? Who should I express my appreciation to? Who should I be thanking God for? So I don't want to forget the people that have been friends to me through the years and faithful people of God. Then the second thing I don't want to forget is the blessings of God. Psalm 103 in verse 2. Psalm 103, back to the book of Psalms again. The Bible says, Psalm 103, verse 2, that we're to bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Great benefits of serving God, isn't it? And notice what He says. Here's some of the benefits. He forgives all thine iniquities. Hey, some of your iniquities? Most of your iniquities? All of them. He forgives all your iniquities. Who healeth all thy diseases. He gives us forgiveness and He gives us healing. And wait, He redeems my life from destruction. He saves me. Hey, He purchases me so I won't destroy my life. Every week I talk to people and meet with people who are destroying their life. And their lives end up in pieces, and you got to try to bring it together. But as Isaiah says, God specializes in giving beauty for ashes. And God will take the ashes that some people have ruined their lives and burnt their dreams, and God puts them together, and He can still make something beautiful out of it. He redeems your life from destruction. He crowns thee with loving kindness and tender mercies. How loving and kind is God? How merciful is God to you? How merciful is God to me? Mercy is not giving me what I deserve. How many times have you caught yourself saying, boy, it's a good thing I'm not God? You ever caught yourself saying that? That person be gone. Yeah, the problem is you got to look in the mirror and say, I'd be gone. Because I'm not as merciful as what God is. That's why when David had the choice about after the sin in numbering Israel, and God gave him that choice, he chose God to bring the plague upon the people. Why did he choose God? Because he said, I know God will be merciful. That's right, Brother Taylor. I know God will have mercy. I know man won't be merciful, but I know God will be. Thank God for his mercy. Thank God for his strength. He satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. He gives us strength. He's gracious. The Bible says he's slow to anger. Isn't that good? All those are benefits of serving God. Benefits of being a Christian. Benefits of being a child of God. Hey, these are things that someone without Christ and without God, they don't get to enjoy those things. But we do. Don't forget them. Don't let them slip. Don't forget to rehearse those things. I was talking to a fellow one day about church and going to church, and the fellow said, well, I work 60 hours a week. Sunday's my only day off. That's my day. And I had to ask him, well, who do you think gives you the strength and the health to work 60 hours a week? That's God. Who do you think gave you the job so you can work, so you can provide for your family? That's God. Who gave you your faithful wife and your loving wife and those healthy children? God did. How ungrateful are you to take the one day that God says is his day and say it's my day? That's the height of ingratitude. But wait a minute. Have you forgotten who gives you your health and your strength? Have you forgotten who's given you your home to live in? Have you forgotten that your children are a heritage of the Lord? The fruit of the womb is his reward. Have you forgotten that he's given you a sound mind? Or else you'd be in the insane asylum this morning. The Bible says in Ephesians 1, he's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus. And you can go through Ephesians 1 and just count all the blessings that are there. It's a great, great study of Ephesians 1. All the benefits that he gives us. The salvation that we have and the Holy Spirit who indwells us and the Bible that we have to be our guide and a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path and to direct our steps according to God's Word and the fellowship of other believers, the church to come to. All the things that God gives to us. Listen, we get all this and we get His guidance and we get His protection and we get to pray and have Him answer prayer and we get God to take care of us and we get God to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness when we sin and He walks with us and He talks with us and He empowers us. He enables us to live for Him. And we get all that and guess what? We still get heaven too. The best is yet to come. And we don't even understand how great that's going to be yet. What a God. I don't want to forget all His benefits. Don't forget those who've been friends to you through the years. Don't forget the blessings of God. But there's something else the Bible says we ought to not forget. And I want you to go to Joshua chapter 7. Joshua chapter 7. Joshua chapter 7 is right after Joshua chapter 6. Boy, that's deep, isn't it? Write that down if you want. Joshua 6 is the Battle of Jericho, and the victory that was won there in an amazing fashion and by a miracle of God. And the next battle was a little city they had to go fight. Just two letters. AI. Okay? And they went up to this little city and they just sent a part of the army up, and what happened? They got beat back and 36 men lost their lives. 36 wives did not have a husband that came home that night. 36 children, at least, did not have a daddy that came home to them that night. And as Joshua began to seek the Lord as to what to do, Joshua was praying, and God basically told him, get up off your face. It's not time to pray. There's sin in the camp. Let me remind you of something, and this you can write down. Prayer will never replace disobedience. If you're going to be disobedient, don't ask people to pray for you. Obey. Obey. Do what God says you're supposed to do. We have people who, I still want to do wrong. I still want to do what I know God says I shouldn't do. But to make me not feel so bad, I ask you to pray for me. And why don't you do right? God told Joshua, quit praying. There's sin in the camp. Deal with the sin. He didn't say, Joshua, keep praying about the sin. He said, deal with your sin. And of course, they went through all the different tribes and all the different people, and they finally came to a man named Achan. And if he wasn't Achan then, he will be shortly. And here's what happened. Joshua 7. They found that Achan had, in verse number 21, well, verse 20, Joshua 7. Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment and 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then I coveted them and took them. I saw, I coveted, I took. And behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent and the silver under it. Joshua sent messengers. They ran to the tent. And behold, it was hid in the tent. And the silver under it. They took them out of the midst of the tent and brought them unto Joshua and unto all the children of Israel and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan the son of Zerah and the silver and the garment and the wedge of gold and his sons and his daughters and his oxen and his asses and his sheep and his tent and all that he had. And they brought them unto the valley of Achor. Achor means trouble, the valley of trouble. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones and burned them with fire after they had stoned them with stones. And they raised over him a great heap of stones unto this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Wherefore the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor unto this day. Anytime Israel put stones out, it was to remember something. When they crossed the Jordan, they put 12 stones out. They always did that as a remembrance, so they wouldn't forget. And God says, you leave that pile of stones in the Valley of Achor because I don't want you to forget that I punish sin. Don't forget, I punish sin. God doesn't let you get by with sin. Numbers 32 and verse 23 says, be sure your sin will find you out. You will not get by with it. Achan sinned. He took what really his sin was. He took what belonged to God. All of those things mentioned were things that were to go into the treasury of the house of God. All he did was he stole what belonged to God. All he did was not tithe and kept God's money for himself. And it cost him his life. God is saying, I'll judge sin. You will not sin and God just overlook it. God says, don't forget, I banished Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden because of sin. Don't forget, I turned Lot's wife into a pillar of salt because of sin. Don't forget, I turned Miriam into a leper. Because of sin. In fact, remember, God says, don't forget, I caused the earth to open up and swallow up Korah and all his followers for going against Moses. You see, we all have to pay for sin. There's always a price to pay for sin. We know the wages of sin is death. And all of us owe that price. As we sang this morning, We stood before, that song lays out the fact that a guy's standing before the judge and he's guilty. Until I heard a voice saying, Father, all go. All pay the sin debt in Calvary's flow. All bear in my body, Jesus talking, the marks of the cross to save that poor sinner who is sin sick and lost. That's what Jesus did. He paid my sin debt. He paid your sin debt when he died on the cross. And Jesus paid for your sins. He paid the penalty for sin. That debt was paid by Christ. That's why we observe the Lord's table. You know why? So we don't forget that our sin has been paid for. That sins have been paid for by Jesus Christ. We don't forget what Jesus has done for us. I should have been crucified. I should have suffered and died. I should have hung on the cross in disgrace. But Jesus, God's Son, took my place. He died for me, and he died for you. God punishes sin, but he punished your sin and my sin when he punished Jesus on the cross. And that leads me to number four. The fourth thing you ought not to forget is when and where you were when you were saved. Over in the book of Acts, Acts 22 and also in Acts 26, and there's three different times in the book of Acts that Paul gives his testimony. He said, what's a testimony? A testimony is where you talk about how you got saved. Now, for Paul, it was rather spectacular. He was a persecutor of Christians, and he was on the way to Damascus, a city, to find more Christians and persecute them. When God appeared to him, a bright light shined above the light of the sun, and it knocked Saul off his animal he's riding on, and he's on the ground, and he hears the voice saying, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He says, Who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. And then Saul said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? Saul was a Jew. Now first, when he says, Who art thou, Lord? He's just saying, Who are you, sir? He heard a voice. He didn't know what it was. Then the voice identifies who it is. I'm Jesus, whom thou persecutest. You're talking to Jesus Christ. And then that Jewish man calls Jesus Christ Lord. Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And he was converted. He was saved on the road to Damascus. He went in, he was blinded. He went into the city, and he was a street called Straight to the house of Ananias. And God had already talked to Ananias. And after 3 days, he baptized him, and the scales fell off his eyes. Saul told that testimony three different times. Why do you think he kept telling it? He didn't want to forget it. You know why you forget when you were saved? You don't tell it enough. You ought not to be ashamed of your testimony. Oh, it doesn't have to be spectacular. It doesn't have to be that, you know, all the wickedness of the past or anything. But listen, and you don't have to know the exact day or the hour or the date or anything like that. But listen, if you were there, you ought to know what happened. You were there. Don't rely on someone else telling you you were saved. And mom and dad, I'm glad if your children make professions of faith when they're young. But listen, when someone begins to deal with your child and they're 10 or 11 or they're 12 or they're 15 or they're 16, don't you come up and interrupt and say, no, 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 you were saved when you were three. I remember. Their assurance can't be on your memory. Their assurance has to be they know in their heart that they're trusting Jesus as their Savior. Don't stand between them and their full assurance of salvation. You were there. You ought to know what happened. And the way to not to forget it is to continue to tell it. If you don't have any testimony, if you don't have any way of telling someone how you were saved, I got good news for you. Today can be your day. And your testimony would be, you know what? I just went to church on May 29th of 2016, and it was just a Memorial Day weekend, and listened to the message, and God began to touch my heart. And I knew that I needed Jesus as my Savior. And the invitation was given, and I went forward, and I prayed and asked Jesus to be my Savior. That'll be your testimony. That'll be the day you were born again, May 29th, 2016. That could be your story. And listen, I didn't have a Saul of Tarsus conversion. I was a young boy. I was 6 years old. But I remember, and some of you could tell the story almost as good as I can. You know why? Because I tell it. And I was being convicted of my sin and crawled on my lap. In fact, the poll labels will be seeing their grandson Noah has gotten saved. And he's going to get baptized tonight. He's 8 years old, I think. And that's a blessing. 6 years old and God dealing with my heart. And I remember talking to my dad on Sunday afternoon, crawling up in his lap at home and telling him what I wanted to do. And my dad was wise enough to say, listen, you still want to ask Jesus to save you, then you go forward to church tonight. And so that night in church, and we had an evangelist preaching, and when he was done preaching, I went forward. His partner there was two of them that traveled together. Bill Halad knelt down, second chair in on the left. As you're facing, it would be the right-hand side. As you're from the pulpit, it would be the left-hand side. I knelt down there. He opened up that big Bible. We knelt down there at the pew, and he showed me from the scriptures how to be saved, and I prayed and asked Christ to be my Savior. Just remember, I don't remember all about it. I remember getting up from getting saved. They told everybody I got saved. And I remember just walking out of church that night, and it was like I was walking on air. I just felt so light. And so did you. And you're not saved by feelings. But boy, I tell you what, it just felt so good and clean and forgiven. And I mean, I hadn't been real bad. I was only six. But I knew Christ had done something in my heart. And we didn't have a baptistry in the church. We went to a lake to baptize. A couple Sundays later, we went to Kimmel's Lake here in Hartville, Ohio. I remember it was cold because I remember sitting in the car with the heater on. Till they called your name after they baptized other than they call your name. And out down you went to the blanket around you until you got the edge of the water. Then in the water you went, man. Saying, hope that preacher talks fast and dunks fast, amen. Baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and down and up and out of the water and the blanket on you and back into the car. But I remember people standing there watching and they would sing, oh, happy day that fixed my choice on thee, my Savior and my God. Well, now this glowing heart rejoice and tell its raptures all abroad. Happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. And they sang that. I remember that, and that was a couple years ago. Huh? How do you not forget that? You tell it. You keep talking about it. Listen, your husband, your wife ought to be able to tell your testimony. Wife, your husband ought to be able to tell your testimony. Mom and dad, your children ought to be able to tell your testimony. Children, your mom and dad ought to be able to tell your testimony. You see, you ought to be able to tell somebody how that day you accepted Christ as your Savior. Don't forget. Don't forget. Don't forget the friends who've been with you through the years, been faithful and stayed by your side, held your hands up when you felt like dropping them down. You just got weary in well-doing. Don't forget all His benefits and blessings that God has bestowed upon us. Don't forget God will punish sin, but don't forget Jesus took our place and was punished for us. And don't forget the day that you accepted Christ as your Savior. And if you've never received Him as your Savior, you have a great opportunity to do so today. All you have to know is that you're a sinner who needs a Savior. And Jesus is the Savior you need. We'll have opportunity for you today to receive Him and receive His gift of eternal life. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, as we bow before You in prayer now this morning, thank You, Lord, for Your goodness to us. Thank You for Your Word and these things You've given us today, reminding us to not forget them. We're so prone to be forgetful. And Father, I pray that You've used the reminders today in the hearts and lives of Your people. That some today will just bow the knee and thank You for friends who've been their friends of a lifetime, stood by them, held their hands up when they wanted to let their hands down. That some of us will just bow our knee and thank you for all your benefits. That sometimes we just forget to acknowledge. I pray any today here that have sin in their life that they think they're getting by with, that they would bow their knee and say, God, forgive me. Oh, Lord, teach them that whoever covers their sin will not prosper. But if they'll confess and forsake, they'll find mercy. May they find the mercy of God this morning. And Lord, may those who never realized Jesus has paid their sin debt for them, and they could have a testimony of salvation by calling on the Lord and asking Him to be their Savior today. That today, May 29th, 2016, it'd be the day of their salvation. Now, Father, have your way in every heart, please. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish praying in just a moment. I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, there's a time in my life when I accepted Jesus as my Savior. I have a testimony to tell. I was there when it happened, and I ought to know. And Pastor, I know that I'm saved today. I know I have eternal life. Would you slip your hand up for a moment as a testimony and say, Pastor, that's me? All right, you may put them down. I wonder if you're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't have any testimony like that. I can't tell you the time when I called out to Jesus and asked Him to forgive my sin and ask Him to be my Savior. And He gave me that eternal life. I haven't had that experience, but Pastor, I appreciate if you pray for me this morning. We'll not embarrass you, we'll not call you out, but we'll pray for you. Would you slip your hand up right now and just say, Pastor, pray for me? Just slip it up and put it back down. God bless you. Thank you. Somebody else today who joined us, you couldn't raise it the first hand, but you'll raise it now. Would you do that? God bless you. Thank you. Appreciate that. I wonder how many believers here today would say, Preacher, the Lord has spoken to my heart. Maybe it's the friends through the years that you ought to express gratitude for, not forget them. Maybe it's just His blessings and His benefits that we sometimes forget. Maybe it's just thanking Jesus for taking your sin debt for you. Maybe it's some sin you need to confess today and find His mercy and forgiveness. But how many believers here today that say, Preacher, God has spoken to my heart today. Pray for me. Here's my hand. Would you slip it up, Christian? Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. That's good. You may put them down. Now listen carefully. In a moment, I'm going to pray. When I'm done praying, we'll have our invitation. That means when I'm done praying, you will stand to your feet. The pianist will begin to play. Bob will sing. Christians are going to be coming to pray. They'll just come and kneel at the altar and talk to God. But you slipped your hand up this morning and you're not sure that if you died, you go to heaven. You don't know that you'd ever ask Jesus to be your Savior. Then when they come, I'm going to be right down front. I want you to come. And we have people who've been trained. They'll take a Bible and they'll show you in a few minutes how you can know Jesus as your Savior. You know what you can do? You can leave here today and you'll be able to go tell somebody. May 29th, 2016, I asked Jesus Christ to be my Savior. I received His gift of eternal life. I know I'm going to heaven when I die. Oh, happy day that fixed my choice on Thee, my Savior and my God. This could be your day. Don't pass up the opportunity. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to hearts today. I ask that your will be done now in every heart and life. I pray that your people, Christians, will make decisions that you've spoken to their heart about. And Lord, these who do not know for sure, if they die, they'd go to heaven. They've never asked Jesus to be their Savior. They'd come this morning. And they'd walk out the door in just a few minutes with the gift of eternal life. May your will be done now in every heart and life, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart this morning. Respond to Him today, will you? You come now.
The cross.
cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide. And its grace so free is sufficient for me. And deep is its fountain, as wide as the sea. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Though millions have found him a friend and have turned from the sins they have sinned, the Savior still waits to open the gates to welcome a sinner before it's too late. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. The hand of my Savior is strong, and the love of my Savior is long. Through sunshine or rain, through loss or in gain, the blood flows from Calvary to cleanse every stain.
Sing it.
There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you.
Isn't that good? And there's two, they're being showed the way to the cross right now, and we'll let them take their time and make sure they're thorough with these ladies that are being dealt with this morning, and we'll pray for the Lord to open their understanding, and they'll receive Christ as their Savior today. And Brenda came to me between Sunday school and church and said, I just feel God tugging on my heart. What? You know, I said, well, you just keep listening, and when he tugs on your heart, you just tell him yes. Whatever he tells you to do, you just say yes. And praise the Lord for that. That's exciting. Amen. And we'll look forward to what the Lord will do in their hearts and lives. All right. Listen, have a good afternoon. And we'll look forward to being back tonight for the service and what God will do in our midst this evening. Don't forget, we'll observe the Lord's table tonight. And hope you'll be back for that. Okay. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for meeting with us and for speaking to our hearts. And thank you, Lord, for these two ladies that have come forward this morning. And Father, I'm praying and asking you to open their understanding. And they'll understand that they're in need of a Savior, and Jesus is a Savior they need. And Lord, I pray that they'll be born again today into your family. And Lord, they'll have a testimony that they'll never, ever forget of coming to church on Memorial Day weekend and receiving Jesus as their Savior. Now, Father, I pray your blessings on each one who leaves this place now. Give us a good afternoon. Make us mindful of your presence with us throughout the day. And then bring us back tonight for the evening service and for a time of remembrance at your table. And, Lord, I pray that you'll be pleased with all that we say and do throughout the day today. And we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God.
Part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sun. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.